This is Indianapolis coach Reggie Wayne, and you're listening to the For the Culture podcast.
This is the For the Culture podcast. I'm your host, Luke Diamond, with my man, Jason Spears. When Chris Ballard addressed the media earlier this offseason, he said two things that really stuck out to me. The three tech drives this defense, and the locker room is ready for that splash guy, for that big name to come in here. They're ready to absorb that guy. That doesn't mean that guy has to be a locker room liability. That doesn't mean that guy has to be an Antonio Brown off the wall cancer to the locker room. That guy could still be a leader, but a big name leader, a guy who's going to come in, demand a lot of money right off the bat. And that's what the Colts acquired today, sending the 13th overall pick to San Francisco for defensive tackle DeForest Buckner, and then locking him up to a five-year, $105 million contract. So a five-year deal worth $21 million per season. Buckner turns 26 tomorrow. He was the seventh overall pick in the 2016 draft. He was a Pro Bowler in 2018, second-team All-Pro in 2019. He's got 28.5 sacks in his first four seasons, 19 and a half of them coming over the last 2 years. And boy, is it going to be fun to watch Darius Leonard play behind him this season. This is a big move. This is a win now move for Chris Ballard and the Colts. And Ballard doesn't lie to us. He told us we need to get bigger up front. We need to get stronger up front in the trenches. That's how he builds. He builds from the inside out. He believes in winning football up front at the point of attack. He told us the defensive tackle drives this defense. And he told us that the locker room was ready for that $100 million guy walking through that door. That $100 million guy is DeForest Buckner, and the Colts send the 13th overall pick to San Francisco to acquire him.
Yeah, I love this player. I love everything about him. He's a high-character guy, first and foremost. He'll be great in the locker room. He's a leader, very well thought of in San Francisco, but on the field, he's a monster. And this is, I mean, Ken Law and Derek Brown, those guys that I liked in this draft, you're hoping those guys will become what Buckner already is. And you know, I get there's certain people I like. There's two sides to this. I understand, like, on one side, there's people that are like, you know, that's steep, a 13 overall, 21 a year. You know, maybe you try to draft a guy or maybe go through the free agency route. But there's no guarantee that if you go the free agency route that you get a guy that you want. And there's also no guarantee that you get him for the price you want. I love DJ Reader, but he's not as good as Buckner, and you're probably going to have to pay him about as much as Buckner. So, I mean, you get a guy in his prime that's absolutely, and I can't say this enough, I told Luke this off the air, in this specific defense, this guy is going to transform our defense. It's going to be totally different next year. First of all, it allows basically Darius Leonard to run all over the field and not be blocked. I mean, not have to worry about being blocked, because this guy is going to take up two blockers. It changes the dynamic of when we play great quarterbacks, because this guy is going to push the pocket. It's not about sacks. It's about pressure, pocket pressure, making quarterbacks get off their spot. This guy does that. He's great in the run game. You cannot block him one-on-one. You can dislike this trade for other reasons, but as far as the talent, there's without a doubt, no question, this guy is an elite talent. To me, he's probably the second best three tech behind Aaron Donald, and he's going into his prime. Perfect fit for our defense. Man, we're going all in. I love it. I'm excited. I mean, with everything going on in the world right now, it's so nice to have something positive to talk about. Whether you dislike or like the trade, at least something is going on to take our minds off what's going on outside of the sports world. And listen, this guy can play, and at the end of the day, it's about winning, having winning players. This guy is consistently good, and he is a winning player, Pro Bowl player, All-Pro player. And I'll tell you right now, I told Luke this off the air, I think Darius Leonard wins Defensive Player of the Year next year behind this guy. I think he's going to have a monster season. So I wasn't sure about it at first, but I think Ballard already has the quarterback situation in hand. Otherwise, I don't think he does this. So I'm going to ride with this deal. I love it as far as the player. And, man, it's going to be nice to have that stout three tech in front of our all-pro linebacker, because he is going to have a monster season.
Yeah, my first two thoughts were DeForest Buckner is a beast. So I know the type of player we're getting, and I love him as a player. But, damn, we have to give up our 13th overall pick and we have to give him a 5-year, $105 million contract, I thought it was steep. But then I remembered, we're talking about Chris Ballard. We're talking about a GM and a guy who values draft capital more than anybody in the world, and a guy who values cap space more than anybody in the world. So if Ballard is willing to give up a first-round pick, and if Ballard is willing to pay him $105 million before he walks through that door, then he must be the guy. So if Ballard thinks he's the guy, my trust is in Ballard, especially when Ballard goes against character. When people do things that are out of character, usually they're right. So I think Ballard is right on this one. He's been waiting to make a move like this for 4 years. I don't think he's going to make the wrong move. Plus, we know he's not an impulsive guy. He's not a guy who had an itch to just make a move to make a move. He made a move because he saw the guy he wanted. He liked the value, and he felt like he couldn't pass it up. When Chris Ballard makes moves, it's usually because he feels like he can't pass up the value. And that's what I think happened here with Buckner. And I also love that we know what type of player. We know who Buckner is. We could be drafting 13th overall and we could take Kinlaw, but you don't know who Kinlaw is going to be. We know exactly who Buckner is. We know the player we're getting, and we're getting him at 26. So we saw the player he was at 24. We saw the player he was at 25. Now we get 26 through 31. We get the prime of DeForest Buckner, who was really, really good coming into his prime when he was 24 and 25. So I'm really excited to see what he could continue to evolve into from the player he was in 2018 and 2019, and now to be playing in this defense, to be playing in front of Darius Leonard, to be drawing that double team, letting Darius Leonard run free. I'm pumped up for this move. I really like it. At first, I was hesitant, but the more I think about it, the more it makes sense. Also, the people who are criticizing this move seem to be the same people who say Ballard doesn't spend enough. Ballard's not risky enough. Well, there you go. He took a risk. He gambled, he's spending a lot of money, and he gave up the 13th overall pick in the process to get a player he felt like he couldn't pass up on. A player who we know how good he already is, and we're going to get him for his prime. This is not an over-the-hill guy. This is not 31-year-old Buckner coming over after he's already put together a Hall of Fame career. This is Buckner coming over for his prime years. The best 3 to 5 years of his career are on the horizon, and they'll be in Indianapolis on that hefty 5-year, $105 million contract.
Yeah, and I've had a lot of people ask me, well, if he's so great, why did they get rid of him? I mean, it's simple, economics. They have both, so they're going to have to pay. They just paid Armstead. They can't keep everybody. I think this is one of those rare situations where it's a win-win for both teams. If you're San Francisco, you get a 13th pick. You can either draft a guy to replace Buckner on the line and get him on a rookie deal, or you get another player for Garoppolo in that offense, whatever they do. I think it's a win-win for both teams because this, for the Colts, adding Buckner to the D-line makes, I don't think people understand how much better it's going to make everyone around him, from the edge guys to the linebackers to the corners. It's going to make everyone better. And I think, and then you look at it from San Fran's perspective, they obviously can't pay everyone, and they already have an elite defensive line, and they're trying to keep, as many of those guys as they can. And they just decided he was probably going to be the most expensive or close to the most expensive. So I think they decided to keep Armstead and go try to get as much as they could for Buckner. And I think some other people were like, why didn't we, try to package our twos, or why didn't we do this or that? Listen, the Colts weren't the only team in on this guy. Okay. So, it's how bad do you want an elite player? So, obviously the asking price it was moved up to a first round pick. And Ballard looked at it like, am I going to be able to get a better player at 13 than DeForest Buckner? And the answer is no. I know a lot of people are worried about quarterback, but I think if we can get the stopgap, that's like the Costanzo situation. It buys you another year. And there are a lot of good quarterbacks in next year's draft. There's also the opportunity to move up if somebody like Love drops in this draft with the 2 seconds. So I think he's got a plan for all this. Chris Ballard is much smarter than I am. But as far as the player goes, it's a win-win for everybody. I mean, the guy is an unbelievable player, an unbelievable talent, and I think he's going to be even better in this defense.
Yeah, I totally agree. I think it's a win-win-win. I think the Colts win. I think Buckner wins. I think the 49ers win. And it's not like the 49ers didn't get anything for him. They got the 13th overall pick for a guy they weren't going to be able to pay, but a guy who demanded great trade value on the open market because he is as good as advertised. So, yeah, Jason, I totally agree with that. I think it's a win-win-win. The Colts got a good player. The Colts did have to give up a lot, and the Colts had to pay a lot. Buckner gets his money, and the 49ers get a pick back for a player that it would have been tough for them to re-sign with the amount of talent they have on their team. They also have a giant quarterback contract already on the books. The Colts don't. With Luck being gone, the Colts opened up more cap space there without having a quarterback. And if we bring in a stopgap like Rivers, it's not going to tie us up long term. And then if we go into the draft and we end up drafting a quarterback this year, late first, if we move back into the first with the 34th pick, if we take a quarterback at 34, or next year if we take a quarterback in the first round, that guy won't get paid for the next 4 or 5 years. So the Colts are in a very advantageous position to go out and drop a $100 million contract on a three tech, who, again, Ballard said, drives this defense. So I'm excited, man. And it's a good time to be excited, like you said, and like I talked about earlier this morning on the first podcast, with a lot of negativity going on in the world right now with the coronavirus. This really takes our mind off it. It gives us a chance to take a deep breath and have some type of sport-related information to talk about without there being live games. So I think it's a win-win-win-win for us, too, as Colt fans.
Yeah, I absolutely 100% agree. And listen, the landscape of the AFC South has already changed, and it's been, what, 2 weeks?
The last 2 days, you know, Jason.
Two days.
I was pretty sure, I think we were all pretty sure the Jaguars were going into the tank mode back when they made the Ramsey trade during the season. Then they made the A.J. Boye trade. Now with Campbell, they're done. We could scratch them off. They'll still be tough. They'll still be pesky because they always are when we play them. But I think we could cancel them as far as being there at the end of the season competing for the division or a wild card spot. The Titans go all in on Ryan Tannehill, and then the bumbling idiot who runs the Houston Texans and Bill O'Brien, who we've made fun of for years. Not only is he the head coach, now he's the general manager, and he just traded the best wide receiver in the AFC for, like you joked about when you texted me, he traded him for a 24-pack of toilet paper.
Dude, I it's unbelievable. I mean, Bill O'Brien is the gift that keeps on giving. Part of me feels bad for Texans fans, honestly.
What a terrible day for Deshaun Watson. He woke up this morning throwing to DeAndre Hopkins, the best wide receiver in the AFC, and the Colts didn't have a three tech. Now he doesn't have Hopkins to throw to, and he's going to have Buckner breathing down his neck under center. That's a terrible day for Deshaun Watson and the Houston Texans. And we've been saying it for years. Bill O'Brien is like Ryan Grigson and Chuck Pagano fused into one person, one terrible head coach and general manager at the same time. Big win for the Colts yesterday and today, with the division around them seemingly falling apart. Although I do think the Titans will still be good this year with Ryan Tannehill, I just don't like the back end of that contract.
Yep. I mean, it's unbelievable. I mean, listen, to me, the Texans, the Colts, and the Titans were the three best teams going into the offseason. Obviously, I think all three – I think the Colts have a very good roster. I think the Titans have a really good roster. Texans have the best quarterback, obviously. So, you know, that's – I thought it was going to be a three-horse race. But you take away Hopkins, that just changes their entire offense. And then, you know, you look at Tennessee, I think that's our main competition. But listen, they're paying Tannehill off 9 games. So I think the Colts have really done the most and really improved the most already. And I think the Titans, I think the Titans are going to be our toughest competition. I think they're a very good team. You saw what they could do last year. I think Tannehill's finally in a good situation. But the Colts have a good roster, man. They've got to get a quarterback, and I think the division is theirs to win. And you add the other, you know, the extra playoff spot. I really love the Colts' chances this year of making the playoffs, obviously. But, hell, making some noise in the playoffs. If they can get Rivers in here in this offense, I just think, and I think Chris Ballard believes this, obviously, that the Colts can make a run at this thing. So it's very exciting in a really dark time in our history as far as a culture and a nation. With everything going on, it's very
and
depressing.
A planet. I mean, this is affecting the entire planet.
It really is, but man, like to be able to have this to talk about, come in and talk about is a blessing, and I'm so excited, dude. It's like to get such an elite player. It's exciting. It makes me think this ain't it. I mean, this makes me think Chris Ballard's he's going all in. Like if he can get I don't think he's going to get Amari Cooper, but if he can get a guy like that or whatever, he's going to do it because, I mean, this is all-in type behavior. So great move for the Colts, a great time to be a Colt fan. I have total faith in this coaching staff and this organization to get the quarterback situation worked out. I think everybody just needs to relax as far as that goes and just let it play out. Big picture, they've got a plan. This is part of their plan. I'm sure Ballard's thought through everything, you know, as far as like contingency plans here or there or whatever. A lot of smoke with the river stuff, but still no announcement. They'll figure that out. But man, I mean, this is exactly the type of guy that we've talked about, Luke, that you bring into this locker room. High character, no problems off the field. He's about winning. He's about his team. San Fran fans rave about this kid. He's going to fit in our locker room perfectly. And then you couple that with an all-pro talent. I mean, this is a huge, huge deal for the Colts. Very positive, in my opinion. I think they're going to work this out. And listen, if you're worried about the 13th pick, the overall pick or whatever, and you don't think we can get a quarterback, I'm telling you, he's got a plan for that. We are not going to – he's not going to just completely not do anything about the quarterback position. It's going to be handled. If he sees a guy that he wants, he's going to find a way to get him. So the more that this time passes, the more that I think about it, the more I really believe this is the right move for the Colts. Changes their defense, makes it much better, makes everyone around them better, makes the team better. It's a winning move, man. Winning teams make moves like this. You got to take chances. It's a little bit of a chance. This kid is an elite player. It's going to take a first-round pick to get that type of talent, so we give it up. It's not a top-10 pick. It's just outside the top-10. So, listen, man, I'm pumped up. I'm fired up. I'm so excited for next year. I think it's going to be a fun season. And I don't think the fireworks in this offseason are over by any stretch. I think this is just the beginning.
Yep, and DeForest Buckner just posted on Instagram a thank you to the San Francisco 49ers organization for taking a chance on him 4 years ago. He goes on to thank his family, his friends, his teammates, and the fans of San Francisco for the past 4 years. And the final sentence says, Colts Nation, I can't wait to get this thing rolling. I'm bringing everything I got to Indy. As the Colts send the 13th overall pick to San Francisco for defensive tackle DeForest Buckner. Buckner, welcome to Indianapolis. Happy birthday. Tomorrow is his 26th birthday. So what a nice birthday present that must have been for DeForest. A $105 million contract the day before he turns 26. So welcome to Indy. Happy birthday. And we'll be back hopefully tomorrow with quarterback news right here on the For the Culture podcast.